colleagues and friends, I think this is a very pleasant job to do, which Professor Katakayam has asked me to chair a session where you give yourself all the opportunity to learn things that you don't know. And you are not obliged to answer any questions. I would take just a couple of minutes, perhaps 5 minutes, to introduce the subject and to add a few words of my own to Professor Katakayam's in welcoming the three speakers. The word extreme or extremism, it's one of those many words of everyday speech which has been appropriated by the social sciences. The word extreme by itself is a fairly neutral word. As many of you know, it came into English from Old French, and the roots are in Latin. And the word has two meanings, outermost and utmost. In either of these two meanings, the word is neutral. But the way the word has been used in the social sciences, it is essentially a negative connotation that has been sort of bestowed on this word. I knew the word extreme even before I knew the word English. I knew the English language. Professor Riaz Punjabi, my colleague from Kashmir, former Vice Chancellor of Kashmir University, is in the audience. He also would have heard the word extreme during his childhood to describe the cold weather in Kashmir, extremely cold. There is a picture in today's Hindu, there are two pictures in today's Hindu, two charming pictures, one showing two little kids warming their hands on the Kangri, the Kashmiri fire pot, and the other picture is of the lake in the winter. So extremely cold. And the idea is something which goes beyond the limits of toleration. Now this usage has, in the social sciences, gotten attached to the idea of a center, a religious center or a political center. For instance, the Roman Catholic Church is the center, and any deviations from the dogma and the practice that are unacceptable to the center become extremist, dissensionist movements. Similarly, as you would know, in political discourse, in political science writings, the idea of extremism attaches itself to dissension from a center of power. And very often, it is also attached to the idea of violence. Extremism represents, on the one hand, the domination from a center, and on the other hand, resistance from a periphery. And this relationship is marked by, very often, by violence. And all kinds of extremist movements emerge, like fundamentalist movements, or like movements for political autonomy or separation. So I believe, I should imagine, that what we're going to be talking about today is extremism in perhaps one or both of these senses, a movement away from the centers of power, whether these are political centers or religious centers. One last comment which I would like to make is that our times seem to be particularly marked by extremism in discourse and discussion. If we take events of the recent months, the rhetoric and the discourse surrounding the Anna Hazare campaign. More recently, the discussions about FDI and about the A.K. Ramanujan essay. I believe you would know about this controversy about the exclusion of A.K. Ramanujan's essay, Medi Ramayanas, from the history courses of Delhi University. What strikes me is that in all these three cases, both sides resort to extremism of discourse. FDI, 10 million jobs will be created in 1 year. 4 million jobs will be lost in 1 year. Everything is stated in extremist terms. A.K. Ramanujan is incomprehensible. Undergraduates can't understand what he writes. Teachers in colleges won't be able to teach. All extremist statements. The Vice Chancellor of Delhi University is a coward. He is a reactionary. Again, extremist statements. Anna Hazare is taking the country on the path of anarchy. Today's Indian Express. The laws will be made on the streets. Anna Hazare is the new Gandhi. So there seems to be a peculiar kind of a development in the way in which we argue positions in this country, whether these are political positions or positions on economic policy or positions on what is to be taught in the universities. I don't know why this should be happening, why there is this virus of extremism which has invaded all arenas of discussion and discourse. Maybe we will have some illumination on this. I add my own welcome to the speakers here, Professor Panini. He really turned around the sociological bulletin, and the profession should be grateful to him for all the efforts he put in that direction. And of course, he taught for many years and researched in the area of economic development. Professor Nandini Sundar was my colleague, was privileged of having her as our colleague at the Institute of Economic Growth, and her studies into the ethnohistory of Bastar are a pioneering effort in opening a new area of research in this country. And she's a scholar who has combined scholarship with intense commitment to the rights of oppressed people. And her name has gotten written into the judicial history of India, with the Supreme Court having given a judgment on a petition which she and her colleagues had, an application which they had put up to the court, to the Honorable Court, regarding the issue of arming, the state arming people in order to take on other people who are described as extremists. And Professor Rowena Robinson, her pioneering studies on the culture and politics of Christian communities in India, in Goa and elsewhere in India, conversion, continuity and change are the themes she has written about. And her very moving and very insightful and very timely work on the aftermath of what happened in Gujarat. So I think we have three highly qualified people to talk to us on the issue of extremism. And I look forward to hearing them. Thank you very much. Each speaker will have about 20 minutes. They are welcome to stop after 15 minutes, but not go beyond 20 minutes.
15. Distinguished panelists, eminent colleagues, friends, and of course the president of the Indian Sociological Society. I think it is a big honor for me to be present here and to be speaking to you, and I am profusely grateful to Professor Kattikayam for inviting me to speak here on this occasion. I am also grateful to him for another reason. He held the sociological conference here so that I can return to JNU, which had been my home for the last 37 years. And when he offered me a choice of three topics, then I preferred to choose this theme on religious extremism because of my location, present location in Mysore. In contrast to the secular center that JNU is, I find there's an enormous surge of religion in Karnataka and also in Mysore. I find that all the secular spaces in Karnataka have been occupied by religious heads, you know, some godmen or some guru or some head of the mutt. You know, you can see his face almost every day, you know, in the newspapers and in the media in Karnataka. They are the deciders. In fact, when there was a crisis in Karnataka regarding our former chief minister being arrested, these gurus and sons were prominently in the news because they went to meet the chief minister in the jail. And then that raised several moral issues. So that's the reason why I am choosing to speak on religious extremism. Having said that, what I'm going to do here today is to talk about what I call antinomies of secularism and religious extremism. For heuristic purposes, I refer to extremism as a disposition to disrupt the state and social order by resorting to violence in pursuit of particular sets of ideas or ideologies. Extremism holds that if ideology does not stand up in the light of social facts, you have to change social facts through violence, if necessary, to ensure conformity with the ideology. Extremism is intolerant of ideological and cultural diversities. It's often stirred up by fundamentalism, an approach that seeks out, within quotes, a pure state of society, a pure state that is intended by the given ideology. Extremism could lead to various sorts of use of force, including moral policing, arson, destruction of public property, or acts of terrorism in which innocent civilians are arbitrarily targeted to deliver awe and shock to the state. I think instances of moral policing by right-wing organizations of New Year Eve celebrations or of Valentine's Day, destruction of MF Hussein's paintings, or digging up cricket pitches to prevent India-Pakistan matches, test matches, are all expressions of extremism, just as Pune's Best Bakery bombing was. According to this definition of extremism, the Maoist movement, the separatist movements of Kashmir and the Northeast, as well as some of the movements inspired by religious fundamentalism, present themselves as foci of study. Of these three types, our Prime Minister says the Maoist movement is the most dangerous. I don't agree with him. I don't agree with him because I think the religious extremism is more dangerous because it challenges modernity and it reduces modernity to a pathology. Now, I have to also discuss, I also have to talk about what I mean by antinomies. I use the term to refer to unintended social consequences. Of course, Professor Bethi uses the term. He has written an article on antinomies of society. And there are many other political science. In political science, it's frequently used. I use the term to refer to unintended social consequences of ideologies, programs, and policies. These social effects quite often turn out to be counterproductive to the changes intended by the votaries of such ideologies, programs, and policies. The history of independent India is full of such instances, thereby demonstrating that good intentions and even well-designed programs to implement such intentions may generate unforeseen contradictions. In this presentation, I shall try to elicit the social logic underlying such antinomies in the context of religious extremism. Independent India's constitution is the single most important document that charts out the principles that to govern the nation. The constitution recognized free speech as a basic right. You know, what I'm trying to write here, I'm trying to build up a case for how the intentions of the constitution makers have, you know, gone sour. I'll explain that in this para. The constitution recognized free speech as a basic right because, as Gavin Austin says, the intention was to instill the spirit of democracy and promote social revolution. Moreover, it protected rights of individual citizens for equal treatment, of course. At the same time, it also recognized Dr. Ambedkar's condition for the equality of citizens before the law that required reservations for socially disabled castes and communities. Hence, we have these privileges for reservations of backward classes, scheduled castes, and scheduled tribes. By interpreting backward classes as a category that could refer to certain castes by virtue of their socioeconomic status as a caste or community, the Constitution prized open the path to politics of caste-based reservations. Ambedkar had envisaged that such reservations would be dismantled in the course of a decade or two. Once these socially oppressed castes and communities are able to attain social mobility. This politics of caste and caste-based reservation has now become self-propagating. I agree with Professor Rajni Kothari and a whole host of other eminent social scientists who say that the politics displayed, these politics of the backward classes displayed progressive features in the sense that it empowered the formerly oppressed castes and promoted the spirit of democracy. But in the process, it also sharpened aggressive assertions of caste identities that led to increasing frequency of atrocities on the Dalits by the newly empowered backward castes, Dalits and on women. The politics of backward classes reservations coincided, backward classes reservations morphs into, caste becomes communalism. That's the point that I'm trying to make here. The politics of backward caste reservations coincided with the emergence of the subaltern school that asserted that collective identities of the oppressed castes, tribes, and religious communities contain the seeds of revolutionary class consciousness. Hence, instead of rejecting caste, ethnicity, and religion, when I started out as a student of economics in MA in Delhi School of Economics, sociologists were treated as outcasts because they were all regarded as studying caste. They're all casteist in one way. And they thought that class was the dominant issue. The class relations should be analyzed and not caste. And those who study caste are, in a way, reactionary. Or they, because caste, after all, was a superstructural phenomenon. But today, what has happened is, thanks to subalternism, today they say caste is class. Professor Partha Mukherjee talked about it. Today they now say that caste is class, and not only that, they have legitimized the vocabulary of caste in their politics. Consequently, instead of ignoring religion or caste consciousness as inconsequential instances of false consciousness, Marxist and communist parties have incorporated caste and religion as important categories in their theoretical exegesis and in honing their revolutionary strategies. In the new lexicon of progressives, caste is indeed class. Any support extended to advance the interests of oppressed castes and communities was, according to them, a support for class struggle. They regarded backward class movements and Dalit movements as essentially movements for the empowerment of the oppressed classes. On similar grounds, they became the champions of minority religious communities and supported and encouraged them in their struggles against the hegemony of Hindu majority. Such support paved the way for the empowerment of oppressed castes and communities, no doubt, but the consequences of such empowerment have been far from progressive. The newly empowered backward classes have turned to be as oppressive, if not more, as the former oppressors. Their empowerment resulted in the creation of aggressive middle classes that have been in the forefront of committing atrocities on Dalits and honor killings, and also in the movement in the communal riots. The movement for the, the usual thing is the Mandal Commission, the Mandal movement was regarded as a progressive movement. It was indeed a progressive movement. But those who considered the Mandal movement as progressives, they, were blinded to the fact that, they considered Advani's Rath Yatra as a reactionary movement, right? Yes, it was a reactionary movement, but they were blinded to the fact that amongst those leaders who were in the who joined the Rath Yatra and who were the strongest supporters of Rath Yatra were the OBCs, were the Dalits, were and also, in fact, even the sons and Mahants drawn from the backward classes, gave a big boost to Advani's Rath Yatra to make it so successful that, V.P. Singh's regime was overthrown. Not just that, the consequences of this was, a large-scale communalization of India. And this is the point I want to make. Of course, our friend, Professor Kancha Ilaiya, he says that, in commenting on the participation of Dalits, tribals, and the backward, OBCs in Gujarat riots, Gujarat, that pogrom on the Muslims, he says that it's an instance of false consciousness. They have been misled by the upper castes, right? Maybe, of course, Ghanshyam Shah also has produced evidence to show that the Sangh Parivar systematically built organizations that won over these categories. There is some element of truth in what Kancha Ilaiya says. Nevertheless, the fact that astute ethnopreneurs could manipulate the collective consciousness of the subaltern classes raises doubts about the thesis that subaltern consciousness is necessarily progressive and revolutionary and will indeed remain as such when they are empowered, when these classes are empowered. The biggest challenge to India's secularism, of course, I refer now to Shabano case, in which I find very intriguing that the secular government, supported the traditional Muslim orthodoxy rather than those who were supporting the Shabano, those among the Muslim communities, the women who were supporting the Shabano judgment. So what I'm trying to argue here is that what we consider as progressive at one point of time may turn out to be reactionary, soon after. There's a slippage between progressivism and reactionary and reaction. Now, my main point is this, that subalternism and all my main point is that subalternism, progressivism, all this is fine, but what happens is the social reactions produced by these progressive ideologies. You know, for instance, I wish to make here, the point that I want to stress is that the Hindutva movement gained momentum mainly because of the fact that they showed up the secularism within quotes. You know, there are several kinds of secularism. There are some secularists who said that the rights of cultural rights of minorities had to be protected to such an extent that even if members of the minorities want to opt out of the customs, they should not be allowed to do that. If women, Bora women, want to choose partners of their choice, they should be prevented from doing so because it will erode the cultural integrity of the Boras. This was the kind of argument that were given. These arguments were used by the proponents of the Hindutva to distort, to present a view that, in fact, you know, the Hinduism is in danger. So, to conclude, what I want to highlight is that that I also refer to other things. What I want to highlight is that when we talk about religious extremism, perhaps for some reason, because of the social logic, what is regarded progressive, what is regarded as secular, gets distorted into extremism. And these extremism play on each other and, you know, amplify the entire atmosphere of, you know, the country. Thank you very much.
Would you like to speak from here or there?
Thank you very much, Professor Kattikeyam, and for inviting me here, and also Professor Madan for your introductory remarks. As Professor Madan said, extremism is defined, and I quote from the Webster Dictionary, as the quality or state of being extreme or advocacy of extreme measures or views. I want to start by reading three passages which should help us think about extremism today and of the violence in which states of order are constituted as much as the violence which accompanies disruptions of those states of order. The first is from the TV program 60 Minutes, which had an interviewer, Leslie Stahl, interview the then Secretary of State, Madeleine Albright, on the effect of US sanctions against Iraq. And she asked, "We have heard that 500,000 children have died due to sanctions. I mean, that's more children than died in Hiroshima. And you know, is the price worth it?" And Madeleine Albright replied, "I think this is a very hard choice, but the price, we think the price is worth it." The second is, the second example I want to quote is from the Oxford Poverty and Human Development Initiative and UNDP, which tell us that there are more poor people, 421 million of them in 8 Indian states alone, more than in the 26 poorest African countries combined. And according to the National Nutritional Monitoring Bureau, 37% of adults in India have a body mass index of less than 18.5. And among scheduled tribes, this is 50%. Among scheduled castes, it is 60%. The WHO defines those with a body mass index of less than 18.5 as being in a state of famine. On the other hand, we have the highest number of billionaires in Asia. And I want to quote from Eduardo Galeano's Book of Embraces, a little passage called "Those Little Numbers and People." And he says, "Where do people earn per capita income? More than one poor starving soul would like to know. In our countries, numbers live better than people. How many people prosper in times of prosperity? How many people find their lives developed by development? The Cuban Revolution triumphed during the years of greatest affluence in the history of the island. In Central America, the more wretched and desperate the people, the more the statistics smiled and laughed. In Colombia, rivers of blood merge with rivers of gold. The third example I want to give is from testimonies that we submitted to the Supreme Court in the Salvajadum case in 2007. And this is from one village, Lingagiri, which says, "This letter is to bring to your notice the presence of Salvajadum for the past 2 years in the villages of Lingagiri and other districts of Bijapur. In our village, there have been murders, physical assaults, arson, and other inhuman atrocities due to which our people have been living in fear and terror. In the interior villages, transport has come to a complete stop and life has become incomplete. There is an acute shortage of essential items for us. People are starving of hunger or praying for their lives. All these reasons have resulted in the migration of at least 350 families to Andhra Pradesh in order to survive. Our houses have been burned to ashes. There is nobody to whom we can narrate our sorrows. There is nobody to understand us. In our Lingagiri, 350 households are suffering. In every household, rice, money, cattle, goat, pig, fowl have been totally destroyed and houses burnt. Also, four villagers have been killed, one girl was murdered, and another girl was made to faint. Another testimony tells us, Oyam Sanu's daughter was killed and thrown into the pond by the Judum. She was 6 years old. The SPOs who did this are Punem Shankar, Bindu, Modiyam Hunga. All of these have now been regularized by the Chhattisgarh police as part of an auxiliary force. The state's response to this could have been many. They could have given justice. They could have arrested those SPOs who did this. They could have stopped it. They could have given compensation. Instead, the only response that we have, that we know that we have, and I quote from the Pioneer of 11th December, which is yesterday, in one of the biggest acquisitions, the CRPF has acquired as many as 18,000 AK-47 and 6,382 X-95 sophisticated assault rifles for further intensifying anti-Naxal operations in the ultra-left extremism-affected states. This, besides a large number of night vision devices, have also been provided to the CRPF and Cobra troops, and so on. There are now 100,000 paramilitary personnel combing the forests of central India. Even the elephants are fleeing in fear, and those of you who know about elephant-human conflicts in Jharkhand would know that the elephants are scared of gunshot sounds, and they are coming into people's houses and burning the crops, and destroying the crops. My last example is from Saturday, when 100 women were supposed to fast in solidarity with Irom Sharmila, who has been fasting for 11 years. 100 women were supposed to fast peacefully at Rajghat, and the police denied permission for this, saying this is a law and this is going to create law and order problems. Now, it's because of the extremism of somebody like Irom Sharmila, who has been fasting for 11 years for the repeal of AFSPA, that we have hope burning in us still that nonviolent ways can mean something, that there is, because it was because of Gandhi's extremism, because of his willingness to call off the Satyagraha after Chauri Chaura, his extremism, that this was the only way that we now have independence. So I want to end my opening remarks with the hope that whatever else we have, we will not give in to the extremism of indifference, because above all, I think indifference and the extreme indifference that can often masquerade as the center is one of the most dangerous forms of extremism that we can face. I now come to the second part of my presentation, which is on the Maoist movement today. And I want now to look at it as a sociologist, as in trying to understand what this movement really is, what it means. And if you look at the common discourses in the media, there are three dominant perspectives on the Maoist issue. The first, which is the security perspective, equates the Maoists with terrorists. India's Home Ministry has put out half-page advertisements in all the national newspapers proclaiming alongside photos of corpses that Naxals are nothing but cold-blooded murderers. This perspective, which is held by the police-dominated Home Ministry as well as by many security experts, argues that the Maoists no longer have a revolutionary ideology and are a self-seeking group of extortionists out to destabilize the country and impede development, by which they mean industrialization. This perspective is unfortunately blind to the history, the ideology, and the actual practices of the Maoists. The second, which is the dominant liberal perspective, epitomized by an expert group constituted by the Indian government's Planning Commission, might be labeled the root causes perspective. According to this view, poverty and lack of development and the want of primary services like education are to blame for pushing people to support the Maoists. This view ignores the absence of a Maoist movement in other poor areas. For instance, if you look at Dantewada, which is commonly considered to be one of the epicenters of Maoism, and Jhabua, they have the same levels of population cover, the same levels of poverty, the same population of Adivasis, but you don't have a Maoist movement in Jhabua, in Madhya Pradesh, but you do have a very strong movement in Dantewada. This view ignores the absence of a movement, as I said, in these other areas, as well as questions of Maoist theory, organizational presence, and local agency. After all, in order for the Maoists to be present there, they have to have been there. There has to be a kind of path dependence of the movement. And it's not simply the presence or absence of poverty which sort of automatically creates Maoist movements or any other movement in a particular area. This perspective also ignores the fact that while the bulk of the Maoist cadre are from Adivasi or Dalit communities, middle peasants and upper castes also play a significant role, especially in leadership positions. The third, which is the revolutionary perspective held by the Maoists themselves and their sympathizers, portrays the movement as a product of structural violence. While they describe people as forced into resistance and armed struggle, there is equally an emphasis on active agency and sacrifice, contrary to the root causes perspective that sees people mainly as passive victims. While long-term state capture is certainly an important goal that influences the Maoist strategy, in practice, the Maoists also emphasize more concrete economic and social objectives like land distribution, drought relief, etc. In particular, since 2003-2004, they have posited themselves as the only bulwark against mining and land acquisition. Their perspective blurs over the history of non-violent but militant struggles elsewhere in India, including against mining, as well as over the contradictions between the long-term demands of a guerrilla struggle aimed at state capture and immediate economic benefits for the people in whose name the struggle is being waged. A sociological, and I hope a more nuanced analysis, that seeks to explain the strength of the Maoist movement in any particular area. And I think it's extremely important that more sociologists do this kind of work rather than security experts. For far too long, the study of these kinds of movements has been left to institutions like the IDSA or other security think tanks. And we have been deprived of a very valuable and different perspective on these issues. I think a sociological analysis would need to take into account several factors. These would include the specific socioeconomic context, the nature of stratification, the specific political history of the area, both in terms of what other parliamentary parties are available and what other social movements have been active in the area, the issues of agency that explain why certain individuals join the Naxalites and others don't. After all, in any one village, there are some people who go into the forests and some people who are scared and who prefer to stay at home. Why do certain, why do young men and women feel attracted to the movement? Why do others of a different age not? It's all of these are sociological questions that need to be posed. We also need to look at Maoist and state ideology, as well as the logics of Maoist and state militarization, which create their own momentum. Because once a war begins, then each side is necessarily pushed into retaliation. Geographical factors, such as the suitability of territory for guerrilla struggle, also play a major role. But above all, it is my argument that questions of injustice and impunity best explain the overall trajectory of the Maoist movement in Central India. So if you look at the current context for the ongoing civil war in Central India, the driving forces are sharpening inequality, the creation of the new states of Chhattisgarh and Jharkhand in 2001, which have strengthened rent-seeking among the local bourgeoisie and political actors, a liberalized national mining policy in 2003, and a growing emphasis on industrialization, as well as Maoist unification in 2004, when the People's War Group and the CPI and the MCC came together to form the CPI Maoist. Faced with growing resistance to land acquisition, unfortunately, militarism has become the preferred state option to ensure rapid industrialization. So if you look at the various factors, as I said, again, poverty exists in many parts of the country, but you don't necessarily see Maoism in every part of the country. And even in the areas that you do have Maoist movements, the reasons why you have people joining them, as well as the local configuration of power, the issues that are taken up vary. For instance, in states like Andhra Pradesh or Bihar, a feudal setup and sharp social stratification have meant that the Maoists have been pitted against local landlords in defense of the poor. Meanwhile, in the Adivasi-dominated tracts of Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, and Orissa, the main concerns of the people have been exploitation by the government's police and forest departments, pitting the Maoists directly against the state. Security experts claim that development is possible only once an area is within government control, and hence area domination through military measures is necessary before people's rights can be recognized. However, high poverty areas like Jharkhand, Jabua and Bundelkhand have always been within government control, and nobody has prevented the government from implanting whatever welfare schemes it wishes. On the contrary, one more often sees welfare schemes being implemented in areas under Maoist influence, if only because of their usefulness in low-intensity counterinsurgency. The large financial packages sanctioned to insurgency-affected areas by the Planning Commission may as well be seen as a success rather than the failure of a model of armed struggle in terms of getting benefits for the people. And the state itself has admitted that the passage and implementation of the Scheduled Tribe and other Traditional Forest Dwellers Act, which aims to provide secure land tenure to people, could as well be seen as a diving out of the Maoists. So I just want to conclude by saying that that when we think about extremism and the way to challenge it, I think we would also do well to base ourselves on the Constitution and think about what avenues there are within the Constitution to understand these issues as well as to understand why people take to different kinds of extremism, as well as recognize the extremism of the state's response, which goes beyond what the Constitution has mandated it. Thank you.
After the opening remarks and two very interesting presentations, you have the tedium of listening to me. But luckily for you, I think I don't have a very long presentation. I'm delighted to be here today to participate in this panel discussion and would like to thank the organizers, particularly Professor Kattikayam, for giving me this opportunity to be here and to talk with you. The focus on extremism or radicalism recalls for me the writings of Zimmel, that long buried figure of German sociology, who more than Marx, Durkheim, or even Weber, pointed to the ecstatic or zealous fanaticism, as well as of danger or risk-seeking behavior of individuals that emerge as resistance to the leveling, calculating spirit and matter-of-fact attitude bred by modern urbanity. Modern life, according to him, overstimulates and causes individuals to become blasé or emotionally exhausted, so that they might seek more and more the thrills of riskier behavior. At the same time, as life is composed more and more of impersonal cultural elements, the urge towards radical cults and extreme ideologies may also proliferate. One of the indices of the crisis of extremism is the sharp increase in violence. Gangs of young men who come into the big cities in fancy cars and display both riskier behavior for the thrill of it, as it were, on the roads, as well as often unconcealed antagonism or outright violence towards metropolitan women, particularly young, educated, fashionable, and or unaccompanied, are the subjects of many newspaper reports. The school shooting in Euro International School in Gurgaon, increasing road rage, lawyers and under trials being beaten at courthouses, and other cases of people meeting out street justice are among the examples of contemporary risk-prone behavior. These are instances that are apart from the more organized and persistent violence attached to terror attacks or to Naxalite movements, which are the more obvious forms of what is considered to be extremism today. Thus, when thinking about the nature of extreme movements, I will not dwell only on those examples of extremism that emanate from the, so to speak, uncivil side of society, and that the state demarcates as terrorists and patently illegal. That is, in the nature of attacks against the state, or even on cases of cultic extremism or individual risk-taking. In this presentation, rather, I would like to draw attention to forms of extremism that emerge in civil society, in the market, and in the state. It is these forms of extremism that we need to analyze more closely and think about more deeply for their implications for democracy. Among forms of such extremism in market and civil society, I would include the recent labor management crises in the Honda and Maruti industries and the indefinite fasts for causes such as freedom from corruption. At the same time, there is yet another aspect of extremism that will concern me, and that is the one that is increasingly arising in the state itself, the extremism of forms of what Ole Weaver calls securitization, which is elements akin to Agamben's understanding of the exceptional powers of sovereignty. What is excluded, according to Agamben, is in the exception maintains itself in relation to the rule in the form of the rule suspension, as we know. The rule applies to the suspension in no longer applying to it, in withdrawing from it. The exception remains within the law, but loses the protection of that law. It is taken out of the purview of law and is reduced to what Agamben refers to as bare life. Bare life is not life in the state of nature or mere biology. Far more ominously, it is political life that is endangered, disposable, and expendable. Agamben's notion of the suspension of the rule, which in turn draws on the work of Carl Schmitt, is critical to Weaver's idea of securitization, wherein the rules of the democratic political system are suspended when something or someone is labeled as a problem of national security. The extremism of the market. The market here refers not just to the exchange of goods and services, but by extension also to their relations of production. In this period of capitalism, labor is treated as the least important force of production. In a time of global capitalism, the labor force is in any case disintegrated, dispersed, and disorganized. The push towards subcontracting production and contracting workers has further divested the labor force of its powers of protest or organization. Labor protection is out. The corporates are today aided by the techno-legal powers of the state in the management and disciplining of the workforce. In Honda some years ago, and today in Maruti, attempts by workers to unionize have been thwarted by the management, and strong measures, including the closing down of production or the sacking of workers, have been taken to obtain a good and trouble-free labor force. In Honda, the company's workers were beaten in a lathi charge by the police under the eye of the management. The government's interest in bringing in foreign investment makes it look with a wary eye at labor issues, for it is believed that labor unrest, so to speak, will put off potential investors. In Manesar, both workers and management in the Maruti factory have taken rigid stands. Who is being extreme here, the workers or the management? While there are reports that workers deliberately flouted quality controls, the management, in contravention of all international labor norms, refuses to allow the workers to form or join a union of their choice. On the other hand, the management wanted the workers to sign a good conduct bond, imposing on them strict regulation and thereby seriously infringing on their rights of protest and unionization. The detainment of union leaders in Tamil Nadu recently also speaks of the crisis of extremism in labor management relations in the current phase of globalized capitalism. While the ILO conventions speak of workers' rights to form a union, as well as the rights of collective bargaining, in India it is only in a few states that procedures for the recognition or certification of trade unions have been laid out. Thus, employers, including global corporations operating in India, bypass representative unions and try to enforce agreements with employer-established unions or with individual workers, thereby undermining collective bargaining practices. Further, the Essential Services Act, as well as we know, as well as conduct rules, are taken recourse to by the government itself to suspend, recalling Agamben's language and argument, the rights of workers to organize themselves in certain sectors of the economy. In the name of industrial growth, willing state governments even put at the service of the corporate the might of the police to create a compliant workforce. Lockouts, good conduct agreements that are imposed upon workers, and the use of the police all speak of the extreme measures being adopted currently by global capitalists and the state to discipline the workforce. I turn to the extremism of civil society. In Habermas's words, civil society is made up more or less spontaneously of more or less spontaneously created associations, organizations, and movements, which find, take up, condense, and amplify the resonance of social problems in private life and pass these on to the political realm or the public sphere. Thus, with regard to events in recent times, we must include the Anna Hazare movement against corruption under the rubric of civil society struggles. The Hazare movement has spawned a veritable industry of academic writing. The movement has been linked to the middle classes, to the Hindu right wing, and even to corporate India. Here I want to discuss briefly only one or two aspects of the movement: the intransigence over the formulation of the Jan Lokpal Bill and the radical posture of using the fast to force the parliament to pass the bill. It was clear from the various discussions that emerged that civil society organizations were deeply divided over the bill, its contents, and the procedures to institute it. There seemed to be cross conversations emerging, and Team Anna Hazare's response of our bill alone did not go down well, not only with politicians, unsurprisingly, but also with other members of civil society and community-based organizations. Team Anna was further criticized for not having representation of Dalits or minorities, and this was answered by the theatrical flourish of having two girls, one a Dalit and the other a Muslim, holding a glass of coconut water and honey to Anna's lips at the moment of the break of his fast. At the same time, though the movement went beyond the boundaries of what might be even ideally spoken of as the middle class, there were certain tensions with regard to the questions of the inclusion of tribes from the Northeast or elsewhere, Dalits and minorities of all kinds. Faced with growing dissent from the street and the Maidan, scholars began to speak almost in a voice of parliamentary norms, the processes and institutions of indirect democracy, and the supremacy of the legislature in enacting bills. From the other side of the fence, angry questions were raised about the accountability of parliamentary representatives, the option of the recall of non-performing or underperforming MPs, and what choices an electorate had when a government simply refused to listen to the voice of its people. While both sides had valid points to make, the prospect of a parliament led to pass a bill hastily by demonstrations on the street, in a system in which the law is still said to be in force, is perhaps as troubling as that of the judicial system taking over the functions of the executive or the legislature. The extremism of the state. What happens though when a state of the extraordinary suspension of normal law has come to prevail? This is certainly the case in some states in the Northeast, where the army has been given overreaching powers and civilians, among them Airom Sharmila, have been on the protest against the state for years. This may also be the case in areas deemed as Naxalite belts, where the rule of law is withdrawn and due process has been suspended. On terrain that is more familiar to me, I point to the space created for encounter killings, a space in which bare life manifests itself most pioneerly, life that is considered dangerous and disposable. Encounter killings in recent times have been used to contain terrorism, a technique sharpened during the years of unrest in Punjab. It is now employed principally not only against those branded as Islamic terrorists. Take the case of Ishrat Raza. Four persons, three men and one woman, were shot dead in an encounter with the Ahmedabad police on suspicion that they were terrorists linked with the Lashkar-e-Toyba, involved in a plot to kill Modi. Hardly a day later, doubt was raised about the claim that the woman, Ishrat Raza, a resident of Mumbra and student at Mumbai's Khalsa College, was a terrorist. The Ahmedabad police was reported to have defended its action on the grounds that the fact that the woman was in the car with three suspected terrorists was reason enough for her to be treated as a suspect. Several questions have been raised by the media and human rights organizations, though interestingly, rarely by academics, about encounters and custodial deaths. The rules involving arrest by the police and the question of proof, the hard work involved in law and police, have been at various points of time addressed. Rarely does one hear of police injuries or deaths in these kinds of encounters. Are they really resorting to violence as a last option? Why does this violence always involve death? Is it not enough to use violence to disarm or to minimize threat rather than kill? Where are the deadly weapons these terrorists would have to carry to be such an immense threat to the police? We barely hear anything of these, particularly with respect to more recent episodes. To what extent can a society tolerate the lazy injustice of the rule of encounters, in which suspicion is equivalent to proof, and that is sufficient grounds for instant death without the trouble of trial or judgment? In 1998, Sainath reported that Maharashtra showed the worst figures in the country in terms of custodial deaths. He pointed out your chances of dying in custody increase exponentially if you are poor. There is an added risk in being a Dalit or belonging to some other minority segment. However, if you are a powerful ganglord, you tend to do well in Maharashtra's jails. By 2001-2002, however, Maharashtra was followed in custodial deaths by West Bengal and Andhra Pradesh. Bihar is another state with dismal figures. In Gujarat, a newspaper article on encounter deaths of Muslims in recent years brings out the dubious nature of the allegations on the basis of which the suspects were killed. The Prevention of Terrorism Act, which was passed in 2001, provided the authorities with sweeping powers of arrest and detention and made even simpler, perhaps, the justification for encounter killings of alleged terrorists. Of the 240 persons in Gujarat detained under POTA by September 2003, all were Muslim. The use of confessions made in police custody as evidence under POTA would also allow more easily for the employment of methods of torture to extract such declarations of guilt. Amnesty International's report on illegal detentions in Gujarat expressed concern that there was a breakdown of the law of the rule of law in relation to the Muslim minority in the state, and used data to show that police routinely ignored legal safeguards contained in the ordinary criminal law for detainees and Supreme Court guidelines for arrest and detention. At the height of the Khalistan movement, or even in the context of Muslim terror, such killings, though never explicitly legalized, have also rarely been criminalized. In effect, the law barely takes cognizance of the